Hello YouTube, and welcome to the next Roots Learning video. On today's video we're going to be doing something a little bit different. We're revisiting the USA once again, and we're going to be driving the full length of the Kalispell branch on the Marias Pass add-on between Kalispell and Columbia Falls, a distance of just under 17 miles. The locomotive that we're using is an SW1500 Switcher engine, which is actually a shunting locomotive. And what we're going to need to do at the start of this scenario is we need to do some shunting to turn the loco around, and then hook up to some wagons which we will be pulling to Columbia Falls. And then after departure from Kalispell, about 3 or 4 miles down the line, we then need to stop off and make another pickup before completing the journey. Our attraction for the journey today is the EMD SW1500 Switcher engine. The SW1500 Switcher was built by the General Motors Electromotive Division between 1966 and 1974, with a total of 808 of these locomotives produced. The locomotive is 44 feet 8 inches long and has a total weight of 248,000 pounds. The engine has a power output of 1,500 horsepower, and the locomotive has a maximum speed of 60 miles per hour. Once in the cab of the SW1500, there's not a lot that we need to do to prepare for departure, so the first thing I'm going to do here is move the reversing handle into the forward position, which I've now done, and the second thing that I need to do is turn on the headlights, which you can see they've come on there now. So just to give a quick general overview of the cab, the white gauge there in the middle now is the speedometer, which is not that easy to read from the position where I'm sat due to my current FOV settings, though it is just about readable for driving. If I zoom in, you can see it a lot more clearly there. And now just above the reversing handle there, we have the power handle, which has 8 notches of power. We won't really be going up to notch 8 much on this journey today, generally using lower power settings rather than higher power settings. There are a couple of points where we're going to end up needing quite high power to maintain speed. Now just here, we have 3 buttons which work, the first being the step lights, the second being the beacon light, and the third being the cab light. So we wouldn't really use the cab light during the daytime or when driving. And the other 2 lights you can't actually really see very well during the daylight hours. Now the gauge over here in the middle is the main brake gauge that I'm going to be relying on. So the red needle that you can see there that's currently pointing between the 40 and the 50, that is the key needle to tell us how hard the brakes are applied. And if I now move the brake handle to start releasing the brakes, you'll see the white needles there are climbing and the red needle is falling, indicating the brakes are now releasing. And when the red needle is pointing at 0, that means that the brakes are then fully released. Now here, the black handle in front of us is the horn control, like so. And this locomotive, of course, being an American locomotive, also has a working bell controlled with the B key, like so. And so down here now, you can see that we have the sanding control, which the sand blasts sand onto the rails when there are problems with grip with a locomotive. And now we have the main 2 brake handles. The red one at the top is the main train brake handle. And so as you move that to the left or pull it towards the position where the driver would be sat, that then releases the brakes. And then to apply the brakes, you just move it the other way. And now you can see just in the top right corner there that the brake gauges are being affected, and the red needle should be starting to climb, which it is doing now. Now just below the train brake handle down here, we have the locomotive brake handle. I think in the US it's called the independent brake. So once again, you push that away from you to apply the locomotive brake, and you pull it towards you to release the locomotive brake. Now just to show you that behind us we have another view for driving the locomotive in reverse. I am going to need to use this at a couple of points on this journey today, but generally we will be driving looking out the front rather than the back. One of the problems with driving from this angle is that I have no indication of how fast we're going, because there is no speedometer in front of us, so it may be that I actually need to look around and check the speedometer a couple of times just to ensure that we are within the speed limit. Now that we've had a quick look at the cab and had a general overview of the locomotive, I think it's pretty much time to depart and start our shunting moves, ready for departure from Kalispell Yard in probably 10 minutes time. So now that we're ready to start moving, the starting speed limit here is 15 miles per hour, and indeed it's going to remain at 15 until we've left Kalispell Yard completely. So I'm just accelerating up towards 15 now in a low power setting, and what we're doing is we're driving towards Kalispell Y. I believe in the UK what the US would call a Y, we would call a triangle. And when you don't have a turntable, then a triangle, as far as I know, is pretty much the only other way of turning a locomotive round. So what we're going to do is drive forward until we've reached one tip of the Y, and then I'm going to have to manually change some points and reverse back onto the next tip of the Y, before then driving forward and then back along this track that we're currently on in the opposite direction. Just realised there's a grade crossing ahead of me, which I didn't realise about a moment ago. So I believe that I left sounding the horn there just slightly late, because you should technically do it a quarter of a mile from a crossing. Though I'm absolutely terrible at judging distances from grade crossings, and I usually end up sounding the horn too early or too late, never quite in the right position. And so we're just about to start turning onto the Y now. We're going to be turning left on this point just here. And so as we follow this curve round, what I'm looking out for then is the following point, which is the first tip of the Y where we are stopping. And so I need to put on the brakes and stop just after the next point that we cross. That's giving us a small amount of power now, as our speed has dropped closer to 10 miles per hour. So notch one of power is bringing us up to 15 nicely. And now I'm ready to idle the power once again. You can now see where we're going to be turning in a moment. The track on the right there is what we're going to be reversing along, and so the point is coming up. And then once I've stopped at the point, there are two methods of changing points in this game. I'm going to demonstrate them both on this journey today. So the first one is the manual way of getting out the train and clicking on the lever of the point itself. And the second is to use the 2D map to set our route correctly. So we've now crossed the point, and I'm bringing the train to a stop. So I have now just turned around within the locomotive, and I'm now going to press 9 to bring up the 2D map here. And now you can see the map. In fact, you can see the Kalispell branch here going up to the main line between Whitefish and Shelby. So that's the Whitefish end of the route. And then if we move along here all the way to Shelby, you can see just how long the route is. I believe it's around 150 miles long, if I remember rightly. So we're starting here, and you can see where it says Switcher 3432. That is our locomotive. And you can see here with the point that the blue line is going to the right there, indicating that if we were to reverse, we would be going back the same way that we just came, because we just came up that line. So if I now click on the dot there, you can see that the blue line has changed, indicating that the point has now switched to send us along this route instead. And you can also see, if we go along to Kalispell Whitetail, where we now need to stop, that the point is set correctly for us to go all of the way in there. So now if I turn off the 2D map, we can now drive along to the next part of the Y. So I'm just going to release the brakes and put the locomotive into reverse, and now give us some power. I'm now going to quickly turn around to have a look at the speedometer to see how fast we're going. And once we get to around 15 miles per hour, I'm then going to shut off the power and put it into idle, and just allow us to coast towards our next stopping point. So we're now doing around 15 miles per hour. I'm now zooming back. And at this point, we've definitely got enough speed and power to just coast along until we need to stop. In fact, you can already see the other track coming up on the right-hand side, which we're going to be driving down in a minute, which means the point is just coming up on the left very shortly now. And so now as we approach the point, I'm preparing to apply the brakes, ready to stop just after it. So we've now crossed the point, and I'm now going to apply the brakes to bring us to a stop. So now we're on Kalispell Whitetail. I promised you that I would show you both methods of changing points, so here's the other one. You can just see here, just the tail end of the point there to the right of the screen. If I now look around, you can see the full point there. And you can see this switch just here, just in front of the point. So if I now click on this switch, you'll see that the switch has moved. And you probably just noticed there that the check rails changed position, so the points are now set for us to go straight on. However, I do need to do a bit more setting up of the points to get us to where we need to be. The changing the point method that way is only useful for points very close to you, but for this particular section of the journey I actually need to change some points further up. So if I follow it along now, you can see that we're going to go along the north leg of the Y and then back along the track which we originally came from. Now if you check that point there, you will see that that is set to go that way. And that is now set to go that way, so that is the correct direction. If I now continue to follow this along, I now need to change this point here, like so. And now you can see that we're going to follow this track all the way along past the wagons that we're connecting to the other side of that siding, where we then need to stop at reverse point one. And then I'm going to need to change the points here manually and reverse into those wagons there before starting our journey to Columbia Falls. So I've now just put the train back into forward and we're ready to depart and head towards the main west yard lead siding, which is where we're now going to pick up our wagons. Probably gave it slightly too much power there, certainly more than was required, and this train certainly has awesome acceleration when running as a light loco. So now we're doing 15 miles per hour and I've idled the power once again to allow us to coast along here, and I'll just go up to notch 1 if we lose too much speed to bring our speed back up to 15 miles per hour. Now I've got to remember there is a grade crossing coming up, though I didn't see the whistle board for it. I'm going to prepare to sound the horn as we get closer to the crossing. Indeed, you can see that there are currently cars crossing the road in front of us. Realised that the point that we just crossed is actually one that I forgot to change for our route, but because they're manual points, I don't believe that they would actually break in real life. If I remember rightly, manual points are indeed designed so that the locomotive can change them when they're set against them. Again, I misjudged the horn slightly. Ideally you want to finish the last horn blast when you're on the crossing, whereas I finished just before. I guess I started sounding the horn just slightly too early there. Now we've got another whistle board coming up for a grade crossing ahead of us, however we're going to stop before we cross that grade crossing, so I'm not going to sound the horn at this board, and I'm going to wait until we depart from the siding after collecting our wagons, because at that point we will then be crossing that grade crossing. So we're now going past the area where we started in this scenario, I believe it was this siding just to the right here, and we're now passing the wagons on the left, which we will be connecting to in a couple of minutes. Your first pickup are the centre beam cars in Kalispell West Yard main siding on your left. Couple them to the rear of your engine. Thank you. So you can now see the point just coming up. So we need to stop literally just past this point here. In fact, there's a speed board just there where the speed limit's going up to 25 miles per hour. I'm going to stop just as we're passing that speed board. So we've now passed the speed board and this should be about the right place to stop. And then what I'm going to need to do is change the points and reverse into the wagons ready for departure. Okay, so I'm now going to put the locomotive into reverse and just quickly bring up the map here, and you can see our locomotive is there. So I'm just going to click once on the points behind the locomotive and you can see that we are now cleared into the wagons behind us. So if I now release the brakes, just sound the horn to let people know that we've started moving. I think you're supposed to do that, I'm not 100% certain. And so now we're accelerating. I just want to check our speed. I don't really want to go any faster than 10 miles per hour here, probably slightly less, just to ensure that we have a controlled stop into the wagons and don't couple into them too quickly. So I've idled the power at just below 10 miles per hour there. I'm going to start braking in a moment to try and bring our speed down so that we stop gently into these wagons here. So we're now coupled up, a nice gentle couple. Okay, the second pickup is at Plum Creek Plywood. We have the road. So we are now cleared to drive from here to Plum Creek, ready for our next pickup. So I've just put the locomotive into forward, I've turned the bell on as we're starting to move and we've got a grade crossing coming up shortly. And as you can see, I'm in a low power setting, but you can see how much slower now the acceleration rate is compared to what it was before, now that we've got some weight behind the locomotive. Indeed, I'm now up to notch 4 of power already. And as you can see, we're only doing 5 miles per hour, accelerating towards 10 now, slightly quicker. And now starting to cut the power back as we get towards 15 miles per hour due to the current speed limit. Though, as pointed out just here, the speed limit is going up to 25 miles per hour, which we can accelerate to in a moment. So from here to Plum Creek Plywood, we've got a distance of around 3 miles to go. At this whistle board just here, I can be sure that the rear of the train has passed the speed board and we can now accelerate up towards 25 miles per hour. Put the bell on once again as we've got another whistle board here. I know that the crossing is just slightly further up, so I've just been waiting for a moment before I start sounding the horn for the crossing, which I'm going to do just here. Again, slightly misjudged. There's another crossing coming up straight afterwards. Thank you. So we just had a series of grade crossings in a row, and I was trying to get the horn sequencing right. I think I got slightly better at the end there than the start. From what I was taught, you should just continue to repeat the long, long, short, long horn blasts when you've got several crossings in a row. Just keep repeating the pattern to get it right. I can now turn off the bell at this point. And we're about to start going downhill. In fact, I think we already have started going downhill, so I'm just applying a little bit of brakes to bring our speed back under control for a moment. We've got a 0.8% downgrade along here, and so I've just got to temporarily use the brakes for speed control to ensure we don't break the speed limit. Now that I've used the train brake to bring us back under 25 miles per hour, I'm now going to start using the locomotive brake to try and give us more precise control of the train's speed. At this point, this long underbridge that we've just crossed, we've now got around 2 miles to go to Plum Creek Plywood. I've now released the brakes, as I noticed we just lost a little bit too much speed, our speed fell too much towards 20. I think we may still be going downhill at this point. In fact, I can see our speed is increasing again. So I'll just need to keep an eye on that. In fact, I'm going to start using the loco brake again now to ensure our speed is controlled. Again, I've had to reduce the locomotive brake, in fact release it completely, as I realised that we were there just losing too much speed. In fact, I believe the grade may have levelled out a bit now, so I've just given us a little bit of power to bring our speed back up. So we're now going to cross two girder bridges over a river. At the second girder bridge, so this is the first one just coming up here, at the second one we've then got 1 mile to go to our stop at Plum Creek Plywood. One of the things I would just like to point out as we drive along here is just how beautiful this route is. The Marias Pass is my favourite US freight add-on. I don't think it's my favourite US route overall. I'd say that's probably more likely Pacific Surfliner, but this route is definitely my favourite US freight add-on. The scenery is awesome. You've got a lot of mileage to drive. And the speed limits are also higher than, say, the Donner Pass, which, although I like the Donner Pass, I find is just a bit too slow. Whereas on this route, there's quite a few sections where the trains can get up to 50 to 60 miles per hour, even the long freight trains. Though on this branch and on this journey today, the highest speed limit that we're going to be able to get to is 25 miles per hour. So we've just crossed the second girder overbridge there with 1 mile to go to Plum Creek Plywood. Just after this bridge, the grade is starting to go down at 0.5%. So I'm just going to give us some tiny loco braking now to ensure we're not going to break the speed limit. In fact, it looks like our speed is starting to fall off slightly with the addition of some loco braking. I'm just going to keep a close eye on that. What I'm looking out for ahead now is a point which we will cross to the left-hand side. I believe it's the next point, in fact, that we're going to cross. And the speed limit at that point is dropping to 15 miles per hour. So I have to prepare to slow down for that at that point. Thank you. just reduce the Loco braking once again, as we were losing just a bit too much speed. And once again, it seems I've completely misjudged the horn point for this particular crossing. So I end up leaving the last blast on for far too long, or cutting it off too early. You can now see the point coming up just ahead, so I'm now going to start applying the train brake just to ensure that we're down to 15 miles per hour in time. So we are now down to just below 15 miles per hour in time as we enter the siding here. And as we enter the siding, we're actually starting to go uphill on a 0.5% grade. So I've got to be careful now that we don't lose too much speed and end up stalling. As a result of that, I've just given us one notch of power. Now I need to stop close to the other end of this siding, but not fully at the other end, so that there's enough room for the other trucks that I need to shunt in a minute. What I've got to do here is I've got to disconnect the trucks which we picked up at Kalispell Yard. I then need to drive forward and go into another siding to pick up another few trucks, and then drive forward again and reverse back to connect up to the trucks which we're dropping off here, so that we've got the full train. So I'm effectively inserting some trucks in between the ones that we've currently got and the locomotive. As you can see, I'm up to notch 3 power here to try and prevent us from losing too much speed. I can see the end of the siding is coming up in the distance, so I'm going to prepare to stop just before that in a moment. And so this should be about the right stopping place to drop off the trucks. What I need to do next is look outside in a moment and then disconnect the trucks from the outside view, before then driving forward and operating some manual points once again. So now I'm outside of the train and you can see just the rear of the Loco here, and you can see right in the middle there the coupler, and if I hover over that you can see that the icon has changed, the mouse icon. If I now double click on that, we've now actually disconnected from the trucks behind us and we're now able to drive forward as a light Loco once again. So now that we've done the decoupling, I'm going to release the brakes and just move forward a little bit. As you can see, we're already accelerating much quicker than we were before. Now that we're a light Loco once again, it's much, much easier to gather speed. Probably again gave it slightly too much power there, being slightly overzealous with the throttle. And so what we need to do now is we need to join the Kalispell branch again just here, and then just after we've crossed the next point, at that point I then need to stop, I need to change that point and reverse back into the trucks in the siding there. So we're just coming up on the next point now. I'm just going to start applying the brakes so that we can come to a stop just after it. I've actually been finding it slightly difficult to get a precise brake application going there. So now to reverse, so I've turned around here, and now if I press 9 I need to find our Loco, so if I click on center player that shows us where we are. Now what we need to do is we need to take the Loco from here and connect to the trucks just here, so there's 4 trucks there. You can see that the point is currently set for the main line, so if I change that, then we're going into that way, and you can see that this second point is already set for us to connect to those trucks just there. So if I now put the Loco into reverse and release the brakes, applicant starters moving. The speed limit is dropping to 10 miles per hour as soon as we cross this point to the right here. So I'm just going to now look forward again just to check what our speed is on the speedometer and ensure that we don't go any faster than 10 miles per hour along here. Now we're doing around 10, I'm going to shut off the power to idle and we should now just be able to coast into the trucks. In a moment I'm going to start applying the brakes just to ensure that we come to a smooth and slow controlled stop into the wagons. Again, I don't want to jolt them too hard or exceed the freight comfort levels. And I'm sure it's freight comfort, I'm not quite sure what the word is they use for it, but in the scenario evaluation they've got passenger, I think it might be freight comfort actually. Not that I know how wood could ever become uncomfortable. So I probably hit that slightly harder than I wanted to, but it's certainly okay. And so now what I need to do is I need to look to the front again, and we need to drive forward back across the point until the whole train is clear. And then after that, just sound the horn again to let people know that we're starting to move. And so what I was saying is we need to go back onto the Kalispell branch, cross the point again, and then we need to stop with the whole train clear. And then I can change the point so that I can reverse back into the trucks, which we dropped off a moment ago. One of the challenges here is that with this particular loco, you can't really stick your head out. And it's actually very, very difficult to see what you're doing when reversing with trucks connected to you. So what I may need to do is I may need to use an outside view just for this one small bit while we connect up to the other train so I can see what's happening, or else I'm not going to be able to see where it is and ensure that we've slowed down to the correct speed in time for the coupling. So you can see we've got several trees on the right hand side here, and what I'm looking to do now is just stop just beyond all the trees, because at that point I can be pretty sure that the train has cleared the point. And so this should be about the right place to stop. So if I now turn around in the cab, you can see here just what I mean about you really don't have a view out the back. And if I now press shift and 2 to give the heads out view, you can see that actually we really can't see behind the train due to the position of the camera. If I move the camera again, you can see we still can't really see what's going on behind us, which is slightly annoying. So if I get back into the cab now and I press 9, we can now change the point and I can now see, it just went off. I can now see that we are set to go back into the siding there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to release the brakes, put us into reverse and start the train moving. I'm just going to quickly check the speedometer so I know how fast we are going. And then in a moment, once we've got up towards 10 miles per hour, I'm then going to go to the outside view at the rear of the train so I can watch what is happening to ensure that I don't crash into the wagons that we're connecting to too hard. So we're now up to around 10 miles per hour. I've idled the power and I'm now panning to the outside view at this point. And you can see the wagons that we need to connect to just up ahead. So as you can see, it's just a very slow shunt move at this point. I will say I'm actually quite enjoying driving this scenario, and I feel that the shunting makes a nice change from anything I've done on this channel before. It's certainly not something I drive normally or very often personally either. But if people do enjoy this sort of thing and would like to see a bit more shunting, then I'm quite happy to make some more videos which involve it in the future, including British videos using British shunting locos. I think it could be quite interesting. So I'm just trying to bring our speed down now to slow us down in time. So we probably hit slightly too hard, but unfortunately, as I say, I can't really keep an eye on our speed once we're outside. But we've now done that, and as the instruction just said, we're now all set to go to Columbia Falls. So we just need to get into the cab, set the loco in forward, and get ready to drive. So at this point, I've now released the brakes. We're now several wagons longer, so we're actually going to start accelerating even slower than we would have done before. As you can see, I'm now into notch 3 of power, and the train is really having trouble pulling away. Once it does pull away, though, it will be a lot easier to start gathering speed. I certainly need to use higher power settings from this point in the journey. At this point, we've got around 10 miles to go to our destination at Columbia Falls. And there are no more pickups along the way, so there's no more shunting to do. It's just a straight run now, straight through to Columbia Falls. So the speed limit here is 15 miles per hour once again, and I'm just ensuring that we don't break that speed limit. Once the whole train has rejoined the Kalispell branch, which it will have done in a moment, then the speed limit is going back up to 25 miles per hour with no changes along the way. One thing that I've just remembered that we do need to do actually is check the points a little bit further along this journey. So if I quickly bring up the map now, you can see where our train is. And now we're going to go via a waypoint called La Salle, Maine. So I need to follow the route along here all of the way to there, because the point is actually not set correctly for us. We're supposed to go along the main route, but the point is set for us to take the side route. So if I just change that now and ensure that it is set correctly, we are now set to go along the main route there. And then also at Columbia Falls, we're stopping at the High Line siding. So I also need to change the point there to make sure that it's set correctly, which it is now. And so now our route is fully set all of the way into Columbia Falls. Having driven a couple of US freight journeys recently, this being the second and the other one being on the Sherman Hill route, I've got to say I'm also quite keen to make some more American freight videos. So if you can think of any particular route, journey or scenario that involves American freight which you would be interested in seeing me cover, then please let me know, because I'd be quite interested to do so. I'm certainly hoping to do a lot more on this Marias Pass route, as I do think that it's an interesting route to do more on. And I'm still hoping to do a full passenger run on this route between Shelby and Whitefish, though split into two or three parts. And I'm hoping to get that done within the next few weeks. I think I'd also like to do a little bit of freight on Soldier Summit, as I've only done a passenger run on there so far. Again, I think that could be quite interesting. Norfolk Southern Coal District is a route that I've always quite liked as well. The speed limits are unfortunately quite low. In fact, I don't believe there are really hardly any speed limits above 25 miles per hour on that route, but it's a very, very scenic and enjoyable route to drive. So again, I'd like to do something on that, though as there might be not be a lot to do, I may sort of try and make it into a more of a question and answer video. So if you've got any questions for that, please do let me know. I'd love to add some questions to a list again, so that I've got some questions to answer while driving on that route. So it is now only 3 weeks until I should be able to get the PC upgrade that I've really been wanting to get for a long time. And after that, I'm definitely planning on covering routes which I haven't yet been able to cover due to having performance issues. So as far as American videos go, then the first route that's likely to be covered from that is the Northeast Corridor New York to New Haven route, which I haven't yet covered simply because the performance is so bad. It feels more like watching a slideshow than a video, even when gaming, let alone when recording, which lowers the frame rate even further. But that's a route I'm very keen to cover. I'd like to use the M8 certainly on that, which was requested of me by one of my Patreon supporters a long time ago, was could I cover the M8 on that route in a certain scenario. So I'm going to test out what the performance is like in that scenario with the upgraded PC, and it certainly should be good enough to be able to record that, so I would like to cover that. Also, a journey in the Acela Express, that's been requested of me, so I'm certainly going to be using that in a journey on that route as well. I see the new route is coming out, the New Jersey one, which I'm also quite interested in covering, so I'm looking forward to that coming out. But again, I'm not sure about how well the route will perform, so I need to really wait and see what it's like when it comes out, and if it's not good enough, then I will be waiting until the PC upgrade has been completed before I make a video on that route. There's just a few minor gradient changes along here, but nothing too noticeable. So we're going between 0.4% and level, and you can't really see those gradient changes along here. So I'm just trying to keep an eye on our speed and changing the power settings as required to ensure that we stay around 25 miles per hour. I think I left sounding the horn for that crossing just slightly too late, as I had to put them just a little bit too close together there. At the moment, it seems that notch one power is pretty much holding us. So if our speed falls too much, I will give us a second notch of power, just to bring it back up slightly. The recent Class 50 train guide video which I've made seems to have been reasonably successful, and it was asked of me on Facebook if I would consider making a train guide on US Loco, and my answer to that is I would certainly be happy to, but I want to make sure I can get all the facts and all the information right first. It's a lot easier for me making one for a British Loco simply because I know the railways of Britain reasonably well, but it's a bit more of a challenge to make a US one, especially knowing what liveries go in the right place, the right era and so on, trying to ensure that trains don't look out of place wherever I put them. But again, if there is a particular train that you'd like to see covered, then please do let me know. And if you feel you could offer some extra help just to ensure that I can get all the footage in that video correct, then that would be really, really appreciated. So again, just leave something in the comments if you'd like to request the US train guide, or if you think you can help me ensure that I get it completely or as close to correct as possible. So I'm just giving us a bit more power along here, so we've just been losing a little bit of speed. Notch 3 power seems to be bringing our speed back up a little now, up towards 25 miles per hour. And now that we've reached 25, I'm cutting the power back once again, so we're now back into notch 1 of power. Cutting the power back slightly more as I feel that we're still going a little bit too fast there. So I just want to watch our speed fall off a little before I bring it back up to notch 1 or 2 of power. So I'm now giving us a notch of power once again. As you can see, our speed is falling towards 20 a little, and it looks like there's a gradient change coming up just here. So I believe we're probably going to start going back up again at 0.4%. So it looks like we're now approaching the loop at LaSalle. I believe I called it LaSalle earlier. It's actually spelt LaSalle. So that was a slight mistake I made there with the pronunciation. So this is the first of the 2 points which I changed just as we were departing from Plum Creek's plywood area, just to ensure that we took the correct route. And if I hadn't changed this point here, we would have turned right just here and avoided the main track, which is the route that we're actually supposed to take. So now that we're passing through LaSalle, we've got around 4 miles to go to Columbia Falls Highline Siding. So I've just given us another notch of power as our speed's starting to fall down towards 20 miles per hour. And I think notch one power should be sufficient for now to prevent us from losing too much speed, though I will keep an eye on that. So we've got a few small gradient changes along here coming now, going from level to up 0.3% to down 0.4%, then up 0.4%. before finally a very steep up 1.4% grade. And as soon as we hit that 1.4% grade, I'm going to be going straight into full power, so you'll really get to hear how this locomotive sounds when you throttle it up and give it full power. And personally, I really like the sound of this locomotive. I don't know how accurate it is to real life, because obviously I've never heard one of these locos in real life, but certainly within Train Simulator, when you whack this up to full power, I think it has quite a nice sound to it. So currently notch 2 power seems to be holding us at roughly this speed, once again keeping an eye on it. I know that as we start going downhill that we will start to gather speed, so I need to keep an eye out for that to ensure that the train doesn't start to run away with us a bit. Looks like we can see a gradient change just coming up. Looks to me that that is where the down 0.4% grade is going to start. So I'm just getting ready to cut off the power and use the locomotive brake if necessary to control our speed on the descent. I have just cut the power back to idle, I think I might have done it slightly too early, as we're currently doing closer to 20 than 25 miles per hour. In fact, we were still losing a little bit of speed. I'm not sure that we still are. However, I'm just going to give us a little bit of power to bring us back up towards 25 again, due to having cut off the power too early. So we've just gone over another small gradient change, and we're currently doing 25 miles per hour in notch 1. I think we may need to increase the power in a second, but I'm not 100% certain. In fact, yes, we're starting to lose a little bit of speed there, so notch 2 power should cover it for now, I think. You can now see another gradient change coming up just ahead. I believe that this is the steep one, where we're going to start climbing as steep as 1.4%. You can certainly see that's quite a significant gradient change. And so once we're on the 1.4% grade, as I mentioned a little while ago, I am going to need to use full power, and even in full power there is a chance that we will lose speed. Just gone up to notch 3 of power, as we've lost a little bit of speed closer towards 20. Once we're on this gradient, we've then got 1¾ miles to go to our end destination of Columbia Falls Highline Siding. I just want to zoom in on the speedometer slightly just to see what's going on with it a bit more. And I can see that we're not gaining any speed here. And so we are now in full power, and you just heard the power up sound there, which I think sounds really great. And as you can see, we are still losing some speed. Along here in a moment, the grade will shallow to a 1% grade, at which point I can then cut the power back to notches 5 to 6. So we are now getting close to Columbia Falls and our destination. And what I'll need to look out for along here is a point to the right which we will be crossing over. And the speed limit on that point drops to 15 miles per hour. believe that I can now see the point ahead, so I'm just going to apply some braking at this point. Now, I started sounding the horn a bit too early for this crossing, so that's why we've got such a quite a long horn sequence there. So we're going up 0.4% into the siding, and I believe that the grade will level out as we get closer to the other end. We need to stop literally just at the other end of this siding, and then that will be the end of this journey. Once we do stop, I'm going to have very little time before the scenario ends to end the video. So at this point, I just really wanted to say thank you for taking the time to watch this video, and I really do hope that you have enjoyed it. Please don't forget that you can find me on Facebook for the latest updates. The link for my Facebook page is in the description of this video. And also, if you value the work that I do and would like to sponsor me towards the cost of new equipment or future projects, then please visit my Patreon page for further information. Again, the link for that is in the description of this video. Did just get slightly distracted there as I was saying that coming into this siding here, so we did just slip up to probably around 18 miles per hour, but I soon brought our speed back down again. I'm just allowing us to coast here towards the end of the siding, though it will give us another notch of power if required. So if I stop around here, we should be stopping in about the right place. So here we are, arrival at Columbia Falls High Line Siding. Once again, thank you for watching.